Well, I'm thinking about like the information that I have in here to show you about my practice, since like this is my studio, but it's also a living space. You know, everything's compartmentalized, so I'm just kind of going through my head about which compartments to open and then show. This is the trunk. This is the where I keep all my tools for making art. And then this is the work coming out of the trunk. These are the two pieces that I painted in the kitchen. The piece that hangs in my closet. One thing that I want to cover like in the interview about like what art, you know, how I think of art, and that is thinking out loud. My name is Michael Haight. I live in Los Angeles. I spent the majority of my life in the Inland Empire. I went to school for creative writing at UC Riverside. Received a Master's of Fine Arts from Claremont Graduate University with a focus in studio art. Haight.space, and Haight.space is the website that contains all my work, and then it's also connected to the Instagram Haight Space. There was a time when I was 5 or 6 and my grandfather was over, my mother's father was visiting us, and we were looking for something to do, and he said, okay, how about I read you this book? He grabbed this book. I don't remember if he had picked it out or if I had this exact book. I've kept this book with me. This was the first place that I saw art, and what's so gratifying about this book is that it's a story of painting, so it's not like specific, it's like a timeline. It's called The Story of Painting. And it's funny because inside of it, in the leaf, there's this painting of a grandfather and child. Domenico Ghirlandaio, an old man and his grandson, painted in 1480, which is on view at the Louvre in Paris. There was just something about this, something that was mysterious about art, and I didn't understand how any of these paintings were made, and some of the subject matter in them, like this piece by Bruegel, The Land of the Cockney, from 1567. It shows people loafing after a strange meal. There's an egg with the chicken feet coming out of it, and yet it's been opened like a soft-boiled egg, and it's still walking around, and a man in the far corner climbing up into a hole in a cloud, and a pig running around with a knife in its skin, almost like a sheath. And then all these dishes of pudding on top of this soldier's hut, like all of this at once, you know, being an imaginative child, but still seeing all these representations of someone's imagination. Just perplexed me. I felt like there was a rule to this. There was a certain almost kind of like a math problem that the painter went through in order to get to this product. I didn't understand what the variables were. As it went on, as a child, you see these very realistic representations of people and paintings, and then you start to see images that look more like something you can draw. And you start to, you know, wonder how that's allowed. So like art really shows that, like these paintings to me told me something about rules and how convention isn't always solid. Convention isn't always what has to be followed. Not to just be the stereotype just because that's what's expected. Paul Klee really called out to me because he was working in the style that at 6 years old I was working in too. So, you know, it's like the ancestor, you look through, you see the ancestry of
the artists that you're following.
It was this book. This book like showed me that I had wanted to be a musician. I had wanted to be a writer. And when it comes down to it, being an artist enables all of that, because at its heart, it's about creation and creating things and the intention and the message. I knew that if I stuck to this one thing, everything else would still be there. It wasn't giving up on one to do the other. The first solo show that I had was at 50 Bucks Gallery in Pomona. It was a show of my work that was curated by Rolo Castillo. That was in 2009. It's anywhere between 1 to 4 a year, kind of seasonally. It's like if no one else is interested in showing your work, then you make your work available by other means, even if that means putting on your own shows. It goes back to community. If you have a community that supports itself and holds group shows, you know, then everyone in the group is showing their work and getting it out there. Like the shows that you're in really depends on who knows about your work, who believes in it, who is interested in showing it to other people. David Festa, a collaborator of mine and artist, he and I work with a piece that he created called The Ghost Gallery. And we have a gallery called Kippenberger Boys Gallery, which is a ghost gallery. And the way the ghost gallery works is that it inhabits a space and changes it into Kippenberger Boys Gallery. And so the first place where the Kippenberger Boys Gallery haunted, so to speak, was my studio in Skid Row. And when Kippenberger Boys Gallery inhabited that space, the rabbit hole happened. And the rabbit hole was an action wherein David Festa took the studio and the art that I had made in it and used it as a platform for people to come in and interact and create art. And it was a 5-day long show with different performances and audience interactions happening. Being Present Mafia, which happened at Soze Gallery in West Hollywood. And that show was a further honing of activities and vitrines where audience members experience one-on-one interaction with the artists and with creating art with the artists. And so that's where we kind of started developing and seeing how important intention was in creating art, which led us to Group of Therapists, which we did for the Made in LA Biennial. Made in LA is a now yearly biennial of outsider and emerging artists. And it was a month-long event that had something like 230 artists or gallery spaces or artist groups participate. Those are some of my accomplishments, that group of three shows last year. They're accomplishments that part of it is overcoming ego, and the other part is creating a community and working with a community and seeing how the community is a vital part of who anyone is. Like, you are a product of your community as much as your community is a product of yourself. It's a big accomplishment to build a community that has that beneficial payout, that has that positivity, as they say. When I was asked to do the mural, or asked to submit a proposal for that project, I had already been making work downstairs in the pharmacy for about 5 weeks. And the painting down there was about human condition in terms of the mind and what is interpreted by the mind, and also how we get to a mind that is something free of suffering. I saw that it was going to be in the intensive care unit, and it needed to be representational. It needed to show body instead of be something with the absence of body, because everything downstairs was more about the mind, and the mind doesn't always contain body, you know? So there needed to be bodies, and there needed to be suffering. Not really showing, oh, that person's body is, that body is broken, that's where the pain is coming from. Or that body is mangled, that body is injured, that's where the pain is coming from, but rather body experiencing pain within the mind.
So right now we're in my kitchen, which I used to have a place in 7th and San Julian in Skid Row, an 800 square foot space that the rabbit hole downtown LA happened in. After that, I went up to Glendale and had a studio in a laundry room that was maybe like 150 square feet, something like that. It was a 10 by 10. That's where we did a group of therapists. And then now I'm in the Miracle Mile, and when it comes to making anything larger than, you know, like 2 by 3 feet, I have this wall in my kitchen where I've continued the series from Human Condition. I think David Festa dubbed these blood ghosts, and it's kind of stuck. When it comes to time in front of them, I would say somewhere below 12 hours. Generally, I paint in sessions of anywhere from 2 to 6 hours, 2 to 8 if it's a good day. And there's always time in between. There's always got to be at least a day or two from one session to the next. So I have time to think and to make decisions. I paint these with my hands so that when it comes to making the scale of like a face, the skull, you know, shoulders and hands, since I'm using my own hand, it's easier for me to visualize in the moment the scale that I'm working with. So a lot of these pieces, you know, it's just, I'm drawing with my hand, a hand. It's more immersive in that kind of sense. I had worked with this medium in the past that was a kind of dye, and I had noticed when I was using it that it dried, and like the red version of it, it almost coagulated. And when it did dry, it still had a kind of dark red color that was similar to blood. So I just knew off the bat that that was something I was going to include in the proposal, because this was a mural in an intensive care unit where people suffered, where, you know, blood obviously was there next door. It was next door to all the surgery rooms. However, I wanted to use it in such a way to paint people who were being taken out of suffering. Like the people who suffered in that intensive care unit, they were also in the process of being lifted out of it. When it dries, it crystallizes. And when it crystallizes, it catches light much more dramatically. So it alludes to this temporary suffering, this almost invisible suffering that we go through. It alludes to the beauty that's in it. And just the fact that that happens is something miraculous. To paint something that gave the idea of hope rather than paint something in blood, that was just like, oh, people are getting murdered, and oh yeah, like cool. Didn't want to do something stereotypical, to stay away from the cliche. While using something like blood in the hospital, very cliche. However, using it in a not so expected way. There is an intention for neutrality. The only time that gender is like really put there is if it's the subject of it. Because if I paint a figure that is a body and put masculine and feminine, any, you know, put features that are more neutral and open, more people can relate to it. More people can come and see it for what it is without any of those other issues. These are specifically about body, about mind, about suffering. I heard from people who saw it in person, you know, a lot of the same thing, that there was a power to the mural. I was mentioned in New York Magazine by Natalie Portman. She was really into the mural piece. She too mentioned that there was a power to the work, and that was something that just, you know, all around people who saw it mentioned the power that was in it. The mural was really about putting all those ideas on the surface, the style being hieroglyphic to the point where the paint was there on the wall to illustrate action. Most of the time, people really saw it for its color, the materiality, the material that was used to paint it. People thought it, you know, one artist thought that it was actually my blood. One thing that I used to, I didn't have a studio for a long time. When I was in graduate school, we had a studio that was given to us, and then I had a live-work space, and then I was in a situation where I just didn't have any of like a personal space to work at. And it's really important for artists to have that kind of space, or to create that space where art can be made. Right now, since I don't have a standalone studio, I have to take the place where I live and make that into the studio. Art is a practice of thinking out loud. There's something for everyone where they're able to give their self to it, and that's when it's successful. And, you know, the observer, the viewer, those who come across it, they're able to develop a message or see the message behind what's there. Basically, this compartment is my studio space. Closets, the storage, and I, like, when I'm working, I'm usually working on the ground. The ground is basically like, you know, a big wall for me. There's just something about, like, if I have the space, I can, you know, the pieces in the kitchen, I painted those there standing up, but, you know, most of the time, it's just always been this way. Even when I was doing larger pieces in graduate school, I did them, for the most part, on the ground. Like, this is stuff that I've been working on recently, kind of going towards representation and looking at the human form. I have a big collection of antique paper, and like some of this paper, you know, it's got foxing all over it, which is the term for these spots that happen. I don't know how old it is. It was from the guy who used to rebuild books for Yale. And he, when he passed away, he donated a lot of his paper to special collections at UC Riverside. And, you know, this was, all this paper was just extra paper that he had collected from books that he was rebinding. And so I asked for it, and it was given to me. And so I've been using it now to draw on. It takes paint well, and it kind of just has a lot of character. If the material plays into the subject matter, if it adds something, then that's also adding value. When it comes to pieces like this, I'm using the material I have because that's just the way the budget is, and
I think that the color of this paper, it kind of lends. It's so much different than these pieces that were just done on store-bought paper. The white is so bright, and it kind of plays to this kind of sterility. It's, it feels very clinical almost, whereas this piece that's on this old sheet of paper, it gives it more of a kind of lends to an antique feeling, or to it having a little bit of that mystery that I felt looking at that art book when I was a child. Art can be thought of as a trigger to the visual sense, and now we're in a place where art is able to give stimulus to all the senses. So art is a practice of multi-dimension and the materials that were used to make it. Art is a practice of message and potential understanding.
A subject matter that I've been working with recently deals with offering, making offerings, who we make offerings to, people who don't make offerings, and kind of, I'm looking at them in different senses, either being very literal or being very figurative. Here, a figure, a body is giving an offering to someone that is holding him in their hand. It plays with the idea of how offerings are made to something larger than yourself. Here again, now the offering is being made and it's a different situation. The body offering is being held in the palm of the hand rather than being gripped, and the offering is going directly into the mouth.
The best artists are able to cause a change in their viewer. Enables them to either reject something or see it differently. An artist wants others to see the world differently than how they already see it. And an artist is someone who reminds you that the world is also seen another way. Artists are like reminders of other perspectives. On this TV show, there was a conceptual artist and a painter, kind of in a debate, and the host puts out on a pedestal this art piece, and it's like a liquid detergent bottle, and it's, you know, it's instead of having like a really bright like label with like a brand name on it, the bottle is kind of in neutral tones. The label is completely blank. It's almost like monochrome, and everyone's kind of laughing at it. Like, how can that be art? An artist's role is to remind people that there are other perspectives. Art is not always tangible. For instance, Victoria Tao, her work was, she took grapefruit from the tree that were in the backyard where the show was, and she, over a course of several weeks, she broke them down and fermented them and made alcohol out of them. And the art that people experienced when they went to her stand was the alcohol that they drank. And that artwork was very transitory. The medium was the grapefruit. It went from being, you know, water in the soil coming up the tree, to the fruit, to the juice, and then the yeast comes in, and then it becomes this alcohol that passes through the interactee's mouth, through their body, and then out it. And never to be really, you know, you don't know if you're going to interact with it again because it's going to be something completely different. In that case, like, what really is art? It can be that entire action. All of that action can be art. Art is certainly more than just pictures. With Victoria Tao's work of fermenting
the grapefruit versus an American brand liquor company is intention. And intention is what draws the line between commodification and art. An artist's intention is to go beyond profit, go beyond growing an audience that is solely consuming. Intention is not something that is born or is part of cause and effect. There are a lot of people who make art and they all have a message. They all have something that they want to say. When you are doing something that is looked down upon by others, like being someone who invests themselves slowly in art and in creativity and puts everything on the self being the means of production. Can be difficult. A huge obstacle is finding the benefit in the art that's being made. What's the benefit? And that's the benefit to those who are going to come across it. It's difficult to give what you're making or what you've made a numerical value, a monetary value, when there's ego involved. It's like difficult to stand up for yourself when you're trying not to be attached to the idea of a self. If there was someone who was thinking about being an artist and they needed mentoring or they wanted to come and talk to me or ask for advice about being in the art world and being an artist more so than just a hobbyist, I'd ask them what the benefit was to you. What's the benefit to you making this work? Is it work to you or is it something else? And go from there. Some people are attracted to the idea or the role of being an artist because they have these romantic misconceptions that are put forth by, you know, the media and just stereotyping, and there's a lot more to it than just everybody's notions of artists using a lot of drugs, drinking, and having sex with lots of people. Anybody who wants to be an artist, they really first, before they even, you know, start thinking or talking about it with other people, should make the work or do the action that they believe is the art and document it. Creating an exhibit, really, there's the work, the product, you know, artwork that's going to be shown, the space that it's going to be shown in, and the time that it's going to be shown. The art season is generally considered to be fall. Having shows in the fall in metropolitan areas is key because collectors are in town more often during those times, and there's quite a large number of art fairs that take place. As much as it is about intention, if someone's out there looking to make a profit or to survive or to pay their bills based on their artwork, then it has to be sold, and it has to be sold at a price that's acceptable to the market that they wish to be a part of. And that's all about competition. And that means, you know, the space that you are holding this art show at needs to be located in a competitive area where there's other art shows so that people can leave and go to the next one. And it's, you know, time. Sometimes it's a gamble to have an art show at the same time as another big gallery show if you're not anywhere near each other. You know, when it comes to Los Angeles, people, thankfully there's an arts district that's been growing in the past couple of years on the east side now. It's not only just everybody located in La Cienega or on the west side. Price comes down to material, it comes down to what you intended to do with those materials, and if that's, you know, visible, then people will be interested in it. Everyone has a different path, and if they're putting their heart, if they're giving themselves to that work that they're putting out there, you know, people are going to come along and notice, and it's great. You know, it's a great feeling. It's validation to see something that you created cherished in the same way by someone else and by someone who takes it home. Making an art exhibition can be as simple as having a space and throwing a party, and it just so happens that party has art in it. You know, when it comes down to it, openings are an open bar in a white cube for the majority of the time, you know, and that white cube, if you didn't have the art there, it'd just be a party, but since there's art there, it's an opening. My favorite artists are the ones that don't stick to conventions and don't give up because their ego or someone else's ego is telling them or convincing them of what to do. Some of my favorite artists are the ones that I'm able to create art with and collaborate with productively, because when multiple artists can collaborate and produce something successfully, it shows that they're all putting their self to the work, and without the self being there, then the art itself can better stand alone. And the viewer is more concerned about the art itself. My work is available online at haight.space or on Instagram at haight.space, no dot, haight.space.